Here. Councilmember Reddick? Here. Oh, sorry. Vice Mayor Kowalczyk?
Well done. Here.
Mayor Fraser?
Thank you, I'm here. Please rise for Pledge of Allegiance. I do not have any proclamations or presentations, but I would like to invite all of you to our concerts in the park this Sunday, starting at 1 o'clock. There is a Beatles cover band, so it'll be fun. That's at MacDutra Plaza this Sunday. We won't have any rain that afternoon, so you can come out and dance. And upcoming, the following weekend is the annual library book sale on Saturday and Sunday that supports all the programs at the library. And if you have any books at home that you would like to donate, you can give us a call and we'll pick them up so we can distribute them and recycle them back out into the community. And we had a closed session, and I'll have the attorney speak on that.
There was no reportable action in the closed session.
Thank you. And we'll go to city council reports, and I'll go to Councilmember Penrose.
Yes, on the, 23rd, I attended an affordable housing seminar at the College of San Mateo, which was very interesting. Lots of innovative ideas presented on how you can go about doing affordable housing. Talked to a lot of people from different cities, see what they were doing. On the 22nd, the library sponsored a Read to Children event, and I went to the, Coastside Family, I forget the name of the church down there, Family Center, the one on Highway 1? Holy Family, that's right, sorry. And read Not Norman to about 25 3 and 4 year olds in their Head Start program. It was great fun. On the 26th, there was a meeting put on by the Green Foothills organization where we had three speakers and learned a lot about PUDs and the coastal plan and the local coastal plan and the difficulty that we may have in our general plan update if we don't consider the PUDs and protect them. On the 26th, that was the 26th. On the 28th, I went to a seminar on immigrant integration in San Mateo and Santa Clara counties that was put on by the Institute of Local Governments. It was attended by health services, human services, planning commissions, librarians, local elected officials, and that was a lot of fun. On the 29th, I met with our school superintendent for an informal just hello. She's a wonderful person, Jane Euster. She's going to be great for our schools. That's it.
Great. Thank you. Councilmember Mueller.
Nothing to report, thank you.
And Councilmember Reddick.
I was on vacation for most of the last 2 weeks, but I did attend the Committee for Green Foothills event last Monday, the 26th, and attended a lengthy Sewer Authority Mid-Coastside meeting last evening, further discussions on recycled water and hiring a general manager. Wish I had news to report.
Thank you. And Vice Mayor Kowalczyk.
Thank you. So I attended a few events, an event for the Friends of the Library to support the fundraising for the new library, and I was very happy to be there. It was just a great, warm gathering of supporters. I also benefited from the very lengthy Sewer Authority Mid-Coastside meeting and that Councilmember Reddick commented on. And I also was happy to go to the kickoff event for the Titans of Mavericks, and we're hoping for big waves and a very successful event on the coast side this year. Thank you.
Yay. I attended a housing advisory task force with county people, as well as a housing leadership council meeting the following day with Councilmember Penrose. We also attended a mobility committee meeting, and this is discussing further the improvements to Highway 1 and the pedestrian trails on the east side of the highway, as well as I attended bicycle and pedestrian meetings with the county. Also had the pleasure of meeting the secretary, a former Secretary of Defense, William Powell, at Woodside. It was fascinating speaking to Professor Powell and his perspective on global issues with Russia and China. And also we held a community choice energy workshop over at the EOC, which we'll schedule a workshop for the council to be better prepared and learn more information, more QA and on that in the next couple of weeks. And what I failed to mention in the announcements is the Pillar Cedars Creek Trail Bridge will be opened. They finished working on it on October 31st. Yes, we're happy about that. Thank you, staff. Staff put a tremendous amount of work into that, and we thank the public for their support on it. So if you got a bike or you just want to walk on the morning of Saturday, the November 14th at 9:30, that's when we'll cross the bridge officially. So bring your bikes, bring your feet, and come on out and join us. And that's all I have right now. Anyone have anything to bring up? Nope. So we'll move to city manager updates.
Thank you, Madam Mayor, council members. A couple of announcements in terms of the concert and the ribbon cutting have already been made, and I appreciate people joining us for that. I also wanted to just have our deputy city manager provide a little bit of an update in terms of the storm readiness. We got a little rain. I forgot what that looks like, I think, yesterday. That was nice. And so all of us have the El Nino in our mind, and just wanted to provide a little update to the council.
Good evening, Ms. Mayor, members of the council. Alex Kojikian, Deputy City Manager for this great city. A couple just updates of what we're doing in order to get ready for the upcoming winter weather season. The city annually prepares and does some preventative maintenance in advance of the winter weather, but it looks like indications are that we might be getting some heavy El Nino weather coming our way. So with that, to date, the storm drain capture devices have been cleaned throughout the downtown area and where we have our storm drains. So you might have seen the Vector truck going around sucking up all our areas. We also have the sewer contractor that you guys approved, that the council approved. They've completed 9,500 linear feet of sewer cleaning in our hotspot areas where we are susceptible to sanitation sewer overflows possibly, so we're taking care of that as well. We've completed the ditch maintenance of 8 ditches. So if you look down some of our ditch areas that haven't been cleaned for 7 years, they finally were cleaned this year, all through a permit with California Fish and Wildlife and biologists on site through the whole process. And then the other item is that we've been getting public outreach, getting out there with our webpage. We have a storm webpage on the city's website that everyone from the public, we'd like you guys to visit. Also, the upcoming newsletter that'll be hitting everybody's mailboxes. The front page is all about what we can do, or what residents can do to prepare for the upcoming storm season as well. And then we're working with the Office of Emergency Services, our Coastside Emergency Coordinator. Staff is working closely, and we have an incident page already set up for this upcoming winter season. This concludes my presentation. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Yes, Deputy City Manager, is it permissible for individuals, particularly along Pullman Ditch, to sandbag for rise of water levels there, to put some temporary bags along their property line?
So with that question, I wouldn't be the person that would have that type of information. The best person to answer that would either be our community development director or our legal staff of the city to answer that question. Long John? Yeah?
Yes. I can try and jump in here briefly. without seeing the conditions on the ground, it's very difficult for me to make any type of determination. Generally speaking, property owners can defend their property, but if we're talking about a situation where they're diverting water and changing the natural flows over the surface of the land, you might have an issue. It's going to be something that needs to be looked at more closely to give you a definitive answer. I don't think we have that information today.
Yeah, I believe it's defending their property. It's not diverting any water. So I just would like to respond to that individual because there is concern over that ditch, like a lot of our ditches.
And on the position of sandbags, I want to just remind everyone that we do have two sandbag stations in town that residents can go ahead and prepare themselves for. One is at the train depot off of right off the Higgins-Perusma Canyon Road, next to the firehouse, and the other location is at the city's corporation yard. So with that, thank you.
Thank you, Alex.
Madam Mayor, I just had one more thing. Again, as we're all very excited that we're getting so close to the bridge opening. And so Alex and I had an opportunity to go out there today, and I just wanted to share a couple of pictures for those. I know it was in the newspaper, and I think we put something in notes and quotes, but this is from today. So this is what the beautiful bridge looks like, is starting to look like. And that's the other view, so. It's getting there. Looking forward to the 14th.
We're just saying there's not a lot of water going under that. Not yet. But that looks great with the cedar that came from Alaska, because we don't use pressure-treated wood anymore. All right, cool. Thanks for getting those pictures. Was there anything else you'd like to share with us? Okay, great. We'll move right into public forum. And we have a couple of cards. We'll go to Mr. Robert Buffin, followed by Pam Fisher. Thank you.
Okay. Oh, press the button there. My name is Bob Buffin. I'm on Magnolia Street in Hamlin Bay. And I guess I'm appearing here on behalf of the Friends of the Bridges. Want to thank you guys for all the work that you did following up on getting the bridge over the Hernandez Bridge repaired. But where we want to go now is to look forward. Understand that the state gave us $1.8 million in order to get that bridge repaired. The Coastal Conservancy also gave us some money. And I believe the city had donated a bit of money towards it too. When Mr. Mueller was mayor, I believe he, in a meeting such as this, he offered that the city would donate, I think, $100,000 or $200,000 towards it. In any event, as I understand it, the bridge is coming in under budget, and so there's going to be some money left over. And so we'd like to urge the council to make a formal request to the state and the Conservancy to use any excess monies from the repair of that bridge to repair the bridge that goes over Frenchman's Creek or the Sweetwater Bridge, because that's the next guy that's about to go out. Both that bridge and the Hernandez Bridge were built at or about the same time in the early 90s. I think they were built within 2 years of each other. State Parks was supposed to take care of the bridges, but they didn't. As a result, both bridges were in an extreme state of disrepair. State Parks actually decided to repair the bridge over Frenchman's Creek first. They went out and they put plywood sheeting over the deck of the bridge, and they actually put plywood strips over the structure supporting the bridge. Then they decided not to do it, and of course, their employees went across the Hernandez Bridge in a court and tried to drive a tractor across it and cause it to be in disrepair. Fortunately, through your efforts and the efforts of some of our representatives, State Parks finally gave us a $1.8 million to get that bridge replaced. And we'd like to request that you make a request to the state and the other agencies involved to use any excess monies towards a repair of the bridge. I guess we call it the Sweetwater Bridge. That's the one that goes over Frenchman's Creek. And that's what we'd like to do. Thank you.
Thank you. Since we're talking about bridges, let's have Mr. Hernandez come up too. Thanks, Pam.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. As Robert was saying, we have one bridge down and two to go. As he was saying, there should be roughly $700,000 left over from bringing the bridge under budget. And he, as he mentioned, we'd like to ask you to formally request from Jerry Hill and Assemblyman Richard Gordon to take that money and secure it for repair or replacement of the Sweetwood Bridge. And we've been talking also about the Seymour Bridge, where the sides of the dirt is starting to cave in and working its way up to the bridge itself, endangering the bridge and the abutments from caving in maybe this year or next year, but not too much longer. City has been working on it. I've been working on it, talking to Coastal Commission to see if we could do some repairs of the shoring of the sides or what they'll let us do. And I know that Half Moon Bay says, you know, what can we do? What kind of help can we get? Where can we get funding? So this is all talk so far, trying to come up with an answer. I would like to see that bridge stay where it's at and replace or do something with the caving and walls, as opposed to moving it east 600 feet. It's whatever we do is going to cost us money. So anyway, I just would like to remind you about the Seymour Bridge. Keep that in mind. Keep helping us like you have been doing. You guys are doing a great job. Thank you.
Thank you. Pam Fisher, thanks for waiting, followed by Doreen Garrity.
No problem. Honorable Mayor Frazier, Vice Mayor Kowalczyk, and esteemed council members, good evening. My name is Pam Fisher. I'm a resident of Half Moon Bay and a member of Advocates for Open Government, known as AFOG. This is a follow-up on a previous topic concerning the equal treatment of all council members. All council members should have the right to place a topic on the agenda without approval by the majority of council members. This issue also impacts the rights of all citizens of Half Moon Bay to have representation by the council members whom they elected a year ago last November. The present policy requiring majority approval to simply place a topic on the agenda creates a very undemocratic form of censorship, leaving those council members unable to be responsive to the public who elected them. I believe the public at this point is waiting for a staff report to the City Council regarding this important policy change. AFOG encourages the city to please expedite this report, and in the spirit of transparency and open, responsive government, to change the present policy and open the process to allow all citizens to have full representation on the City Council by allowing all duly elected officials to place a topic on the agenda. And I might also just want to say, since AFOG is a nonpartisan group, this is a policy we would support no matter who is in the majority. This is an issue of equity and open government. The other issue I would like to address is videoing the Planning Commission meetings. The stars were not aligned for the last meeting, and neither I nor any other AFOG member nor City Council members were present at that meeting concerning the charrette. We, aside from calling the Planning Commission members to find out what happened, we really don't have a means for public disclosure of what occurs at those meetings. So I and AFOG urge the city, even though we've been assured that this is in process, to please expedite this issue and make plans for providing videoing of the Planning Commission meetings. It's a very important group, and the public really wants to know what's happening. Thank you.
Thank you. Doreen Garrity, followed by Paul Gregory.
Hello, my name is Doreen Garrity, and tonight I'm speaking on behalf of Advocates for Open Government, or AFOG. I'm just here tonight to remind all of you about the invitation that I extended to you a couple weeks ago in regards to AFOG's kickoff meeting. Well, our meeting is just right around the corner. It's coming up this Sunday, which is November 8th, and it's going to be right here at the Ted Atcock Center from 3 to 5 p.m. I'm also extremely pleased to announce that Gary Patton, a former Santa Cruz County supervisor who served 20 years, will be our keynote speaker. So I'm really hoping that our city council members and staff and the public will join us. We're really excited about this, and I like to get together so we can come up with some creative and great ideas for our Coastside community. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Paul, followed by Dave Shore. Sir, is it Grigoriev?
It's Grigoriev.
Grigoriev, okay.
Just like it's written.
I'll think of it San Gregorio, so Grigoriev.
Grigoriev.
Thank
the
you.
Think of the chant. This comment will be refreshingly brief, I think. I appeared before you with a comment 2 weeks ago at your meeting, and this is sort of a comment about comments, because I turned in a one-page transcript of my remarks and said, well, can this be included in the minutes? And I was told yes. Well, I looked at the minutes and I didn't see anything. And apparently that's because comments, even one-page transcripts of comments, go apparently in something called the file. The clerk informed me there is a file on every meeting, and if you wish to see them, you can ask to see the file and go into it and get that back. But I'd just like to make the suggestion that if you do get written transcripts of comments, that you strongly consider actually placing those in the published minutes. I haven't been to too many meetings thus far, but I've seen and heard a lot of comments, and some of them, I think, could have generated simple summaries. If you get that, I think you should consider placing those on the public record so that they can be seen by anyone who pulls the packet and takes a look at it. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And last card is from Dave Shore.
Good evening, Mayor, Council Members, staff, friends, and neighbors. I'm Dave Shore. I am treasurer for the Friends of the Library, the nonprofit organization which provides funding for the ongoing programmatic needs of the library, and we're also engaged in fundraising for the new library project. I would like to clarify, the Friends of the Library has a stated goal of raising up to $2 million, or if we can, more, towards the cost of the new library. This is not a pledge of money, as some have said, but is a goal. Whether we reach this goal or not is dependent on the good graces and the generosity of the members of our community. We hope we get there. But to that end, Councilmember Kowalczyk made reference to a fundraising event that we had over the weekend at a donor's home south of town. That donor kicked off our fundraising with a $100,000 donation, and that evening there was over an additional $100,000 donated. In addition to money we had already received from people over the past year or so, we're now at about $275,000 in donations, which we're holding until the city arranges for transfer, and we will continue raising funds through a lot of outreach. I have donation envelopes here. Everybody can go to coastsidelibrary.org, and we have PayPal there, so you can donate. Any amount helps. A dollar, $1,000, $1 million, it all goes to the same fund. I would like to point out, it's an interesting thing when we looked at the donations and where they came from at that fundraiser last Friday night. Of the somewhat over $200,000 that we raised, $160,000 of that came from donors outside of city limits, people in unincorporated areas of the county. So that's wonderful, it's fantastic, it shows the support that this project has throughout the region, but in some ways it's a little bit of a challenge, I think, to the citizens of Half Moon Bay to step up and help us out with this project. Thank you very much. CoastsideLibrary.org.
Thank you. All right, we move now out of public forum into consent calendar.
Madam Mayor, if I could just maybe respond to a couple of items that were raised today very, very briefly.
Absolutely.
I just don't want folks to walk away with misinformation. The funding that we received from the state parks and from the Coastal Conservancy were allocated dollars. They were not given dollars, so we don't have money in the bank. So they're just allocated sort of up to dollar amount. We have been thinking about trying to go back to both the state and the Conservancy for assistance with the other bridges, but we want to make sure that we have a final accounting of this bridge. As you see, it's still in process. We want to make sure that that gets done. We, of course, want to make sure that the approach, similar to the approach that we took with this bridge, is done in a manner that is appropriate, timely, sensitive, so that we can maximize their ability to be successful with that. So staff is working on that, and we will do so, I think, appropriately. And I think we've built some really good relationships to make that happen. I also wanted to mention that, in fact, we are working on getting the Planning Commission meetings videotaped. I will assure you that the delay is not on behalf of the city, and so we're trying to figure out how to make sure that that happens, because we certainly have a similar interest to make sure that the council meetings, that the Planning Commission meetings are available to the public. They, of course, are open for people to attend, but we'd like to make them available by video as well. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Now we move to consent calendar, and we are pulling items number 5, 6, and 7, and number 4. Now, are we're pulling 5, 6, and 7 to come back at another time. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And 4, just for discussion, that's not tonight.
So the other ones would be postponed to a future meeting.
That's correct. Yes, we'll bring those back.
Yeah, no, I just had questions about 4. I think we could pull that.
Okay. Are there any others? And if not, may I have a motion?
I move to approve consent items 1, 2, and 3. Sorry.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Councilmember Mueller?
Yes.
Councilmember Penrose?
Aye.
Councilmember Reddick?
Aye.
Vice Mayor Kowalczyk?
Yes.
Mayor Fraser?
Yes. Thank you. And do you want to go right to number 4? Okay.
So I sent a question query to staff earlier
today. Your microphone's not on.
I sent a query to staff earlier today about this item. In August of 2014, it was the August 19th meeting, the council approved a contract with NBS to do a cost allocation study, an update of the AB 1600 report, and a fee study. And I don't recall ever seeing the deliverables, and it looks like this particular report is not consistent with the scope of work approved by NBS. This looks more like a staff-generated report. Here's what we spent, you know, this year. So I'm just wondering whatever happened to the NBS report and...
I responded, but you were, I was here and you were there, so you probably didn't get a chance to read it. I'm going to try and then ask for help if I'm not being real clear. So the report tonight has nothing to do with the contract itself, the NBS contract itself. This is an annual report in terms of development impact fees in order to comply with the government section code 66000 and state mitigation fee act AB 1600. The results of the study prepared by NBSB will be presented to council, we expect, at the next council meeting. Yulia and our community development director, interim community development director and finance director, came in after the August date, and so they've inherited that contract. They've been working very hard to try to finalize that information. It's been less than easy in terms of the ability to gather data, frankly. They have two additional deliverables that they need to complete, they being NBS, the development impact fees and the user fees. We felt that it made sense to update the base data for fiscal year 13-14 to fiscal year 14-15. We know that it's caused some delay, but we thought that it would be better to have the more accurate data at least. So again, we're tentatively scheduled for the November 17th meeting to bring to the council. We'll have the public hearing tentatively for December 15th, again, assuming that the council approves it then on the 17th, and then we'll finalize the user fees and bring those back to the council in January.
Great, thanks so much. I would just suggest, in some sections, there's an explanation of what the money was spent on, for instance, the park fees. The stormwater fees, it's unclear. So I would just ask that, you know, future reports, and that for every section actually spell out what projects receive those funds. That's all. So
happy to do that.
Okay, thanks.
Can we vote on item number four then? Right.
Move to accept the report.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. All in favor of approving item number four, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Nay. No nays, no abstentions. Motion passes. Thank you. Now we'll skip over to item number eight, and this is Plan Half Moon Bay Planning Boundaries and Work Plan. And we have Jill with us this evening.
Good evening, Madam Mayor and members of the City Council. I'm Jill Ekus. I am your General Plan Management Analyst, and I'm happy to be back tonight to take a look at some items with respect to the Plan Half Moon Bay process. I'll be presenting a few slides focused on process. The other item pertaining to Plan Half Moon Bay, the General Plan Advisory Committee appointment, will be covered by the city manager and the community development director after this presentation. So just want to share that scope. There we go. So for this brief presentation, we will highlight some background items and then get right into the two topics, which are charrette and planning boundaries. For background, Council considered these topics previously at your October 6th meeting. At that meeting, you provided feedback about options for planning boundaries, and you also expressed interest in a charrette and specifically requested that the Planning Commission provide their input regarding a charrette. The Commission met last Tuesday and held that discussion, which is summarized on the next slide. Just a note, we also met with the Parks and Recreation Committee last week. Regarding Plan Half Moon Bay, they were not focused on policy issues, so they were different matters than this, but we just like to note all of the public forums that we're having for Plan Half Moon Bay every time we see you. All right. This is our summary from the Planning Commission's October 27th thoughtful discussion about a charrette. The three main areas that we focused on, first of all, was the sequence and timing, and second, really the gist of the charrette, the scope and its purpose, and then thirdly was a process point with respect to forming an ad hoc committee. With regards to all of these things, the Commission generally supported the staff recommendations and provided more information and guidance with respect to those. They agreed to complete the synthesis process that has, we're about halfway through it, and we as staff think we can get that done in 2015. And then the commission sees that a charrette could be well planned for in Q1 of 2016, probably not until March, realistically. There's quite a bit of background work that goes into this. Commission also agreed on focusing on the core area as the appropriate geographic scope for the charrette. And they noted beyond really land use and transportation, it's most likely that a charrette is going to stir up all kinds of input across the board, really, on all the general plan topics. And we agree. We think that's fine. We don't want to put a cap on that. They're all interrelated. With respect to the ad hoc committee, They were appointed to see the process through, and we are very grateful to Vice Chair Roman and Commissioner Evans, I think he's here somewhere, who will be that committee. And staff will support them in our efforts to get more detail into the planning for the charrette. So we're looking for council's direction regarding this and to see if you confirm the Planning Commission's discussions and recommendations on that. I'm going to move right on, though, to the planning boundaries. And so we're going to think about two. One's the project area as a whole, and the other is the core area. Got two slides looking at the project area. Right now, the project area for Plan Half Moon Bay consists of the entire city limits and three additional contiguous unincorporated areas. Two of those are shown on this slide. One is the city-owned Johnson House, and another is down, I'm not gonna do this right. You can see just above where that Moon Ridge call out with the red boundary, there's at the south end of Highway 1, on the east side are some commercial properties that were also added into the study area, as well as some properties on the south side of Highway 92 that are in commercial use between the city limit line and the bridge over Pillar Cedars Creek, basically Spanish Town to the Half Moon Bay Nursery. We believe that council is interested in adding Moon Ridge to the study area. It's approximately 40 acres, and it's schematically depicted on this map. And then the other area we wanted to note for your thinking for the planning boundary, we discussed it a little bit. We aren't really sure how interested you are in it, but I'll go ahead and present some information about it so that you can make your consideration. It's a small area that we're showing here. It's only about 6 acres on the north side of Highway 92, basically ranging from Bongards to Limos Farm. And if council is interested in adding this area, we would recommend just the property frontages for a depth of about 100 feet. This comes to be for a couple reasons. One is that quite a few of those properties actually are overall accumulations of properties for each business actually have frontage properties that are about 100 feet deep. And also that's where, of course, the points of access are located and the parking configurations. And it's really that part of the property and those businesses that affect the function of Highway 92, which is what the community is has expressed their greatest interest in. So Moon Ridge, and then this is the other piece that we bring back to you for consideration for the planning boundary. And then let's talk about the core boundary. So we discussed this one as well on October 6th. This map is revised from what you saw last time, although that purple boundary is the same for reference. This is that boundary that we used in the August Transportation and Land Use Workshop, which is where we were expecting to get feedback about that idea, and we did, in particular that it was too big. And so we told you about that on October 6th, and we showed you a boundary in blue that stopped at Highway 92 and also had some other modifications from what you're seeing here. We tried to follow your discussion and represent it in this map. We might not have gotten all of that right, but let me cover what we did adjust from what you saw last time. We believe from your discussion that you're interested in, it's okay to cross 92 to include the commercial uses on the 92 and Highway 1 interchange. And so that's what you see at the north end of that blue boundary. We also heard feedback about including gateways and making sure that even if areas that were significant with respect to transportation and community identity, even if they're not specifically in the boundary, that we map them relative to the core area because they're related and we want that to be part of our planning context. And so you'll see Gateway in particular at Highway 1 at Kelly, and then also on Highway 92 at Main Street. And we show and it's hard to see it because the boundary line covers the symbol, but at the south end of this boundary at Main Street's southern intersection with Highway 1 is also we believe a really strong gateway location for the city. And so that's why we extended the boundary that far south. We know in your discussion that we got mixed input, so we really weren't sure what to show for that. We do want to note a couple more things. We're still showing those strong connections on Kelly and Poplar between the core area and the beaches. And we also intentionally drew the boundary to include, in particular, John Carter Park, because that could have been cut in there. But we and then Kitty Fernandez Park is also in the area, as well as the bike ped bridge immediately adjacent to Oak Avenue Park. We'd recommend including these public spaces because they're such a significant part of the land use portfolio for a downtown or a core area. It would be perfectly fine from our perspective to also include Oak Avenue Park, but we hadn't talked about it before, so I didn't map it that way. So that's why that looks the way it does, and we're open for that feedback. Oops. So we are looking forward to your direction tonight, and in wrapping up this presentation, we just want to note pending next steps that we think would follow your discussion. We're not entirely sure, but just so that you know what we're thinking, we're working towards, which would be a final synthesis workshop and also getting back with the General Plan Advisory Committee. And of course, we are here to happily answer clarifying questions. And just to sum up, that the considerations before you tonight are about the charrette and the planning area boundary and the core area boundary. And we'll look at GPEC with your next item. So thanks.
Thank you, Jill. Council, there's no cards on this, so bring it back to us to discuss what you would like to include, not include. Councilmember Penrose.
Yeah, I would like to address the core area, and I'm concerned that including Safeway, does it go over Highway 1 to the Strawflower Village? Is that on this map? Yeah, I don't consider that part of downtown, and I don't know that it's really, when you describe a half mile radius as being one of the parameters that you choose to describe a walkable distance, I don't know anybody besides myself who walks to Safeway from downtown, or even who walks over to New Leaf from downtown, or walks over to the high school from downtown. So I would like to see the core boundary stop at Highway 92 and not go beyond that, north of 92.
Well, my feeling is I see a lot of people walking to the high school, number one. Number two, I see a lot of people walking to our Hassock hardware store. I believe they are a valuable asset to the core of our city. That's my personal opinion.
No, there are a lot of people. Jill, you had mentioned Oak Avenue, and I think that was important. That area gets left off sometimes. But there are a lot of people that do walk and take their strollers and go over to Safeway, go over to the bank, and you've got a steady stream of kids that come down from the high school that go through Main Street. So I think, you know, the half-mile radius is still... I think it's still important to include that because that can help us with pedestrian trails to get people have better access through those areas that make that whole area much more walkable. Because right now people are walking on the highways to get over into that area. So, you know, I see them. I see them with their strollers. I see them with their messages. They've got their bags coming across there. That's a big part of it. And you certainly see the kids coming down every day and coming down through Main Street. And just while I'm chatting, I would like to include Moon Ridge in there after having spoke to that group. And again, I think that can help with some pedestrian trails. We're looking at expanding on the east side of the highway, and that was something the group of people who work and go to school in Half Moon Bay, they would not take their cars. If there was a safer pathway from Moon Ridge into town, they would be using their bikes as alternative transportation.
I agree about including Moon Ridge for sure. I do beg to differ with you about the Safeway Shopping Center. It's part of our commercial core. It's our retail center. And we want to assure that, you know, those areas are walkable. There's been talk of a plan for years about hopefully acquiring an easement at Tom and Pete's someday so that people can walk on a trail from, you know, Main Street directly underneath Highway 1 to the Safeway Shopping Center. So I think we want to include as much as we can to create opportunities. And in terms of grant funding, maps are really important. You need the areas that you want funded to be, you know, in formal maps that are part of formal plans. For instance, if ever we wanted to update the zoning for Straw Flower Center, we would, and we might need some infrastructure financing to, you know, use as a subsidy. You want that to be recognized as a formal planning area. So, and for that same reason, I'd like us to include our public parks and other public spaces that are located in the downtown area to be part of the plan. So that makes sense to me. Spanish Town, that makes a lot of sense to me. One question I have, though, I'm not quite sure I understand. I'm looking at the map, SR92. Has that entire length of Highway 92 always been part of the planning area, or is that new? I noticed that the commercial area on the east side is bounded in blue, but the rest of the planning area along 92 is in red. So I'm not sure what's new and what's existing.
That is a reasonable question. I did not cover that. The red area south of Highway 92 has been included in the planning area for as long as I have been working on this project. I don't know when it was decided, and specifically when that first came into being, but it's in the existing conditions report from summer 2014. And my understanding from staff is the intention was to capture the greenhouse and the nursery-oriented businesses there for the same reason that I just noted about access points and parking that your community is interested in.
A follow-on question. So have the owners of the ag land and the owners of the to-be-added commercial areas, have they been, you know, notified that they're to be included in the planning area? I'm guessing some might, you know, not like that, just knowing what I know about the history of those properties and the owners, et cetera. So I'm just wondering the status of those relationships.
I do not know what has gone on before. I haven't made those contacts. We certainly, and if you amend the planning area, we would need to do some of that outreach. Remembering, of course, that these unincorporated areas are not Half Moon Bay's jurisdiction. They still do bear import on planning for this community. And so it's a different status in terms of having the city limits, which is very specifically going to be affected by your plan, as opposed to these additional areas, which my understanding is no one's intending to change the city sphere or incorporate. It's more of an advisory and observation type of input that we'll be getting from that, and coordination with the county or other jurisdictions. I've been talking to Steve Monowitz over in San Mateo County Building and Planning about it, and he sees kind of the flip side of Half Moon Bay being included in Connect the Coast side. So it's a thinking about that context. I don't know if that helps, but.
One follow-on question. So I'm trying to understand why we would include those commercial properties on the north side of 92.
Right. So what we heard your community members say, and we heard it pretty much at every meeting, was a lot of ongoing concerns about the Highway 92 with respect to safety, congestion, and basically how it affects folks on a fairly regular basis, often daily. And this stretch, specifically between the blue, so this idea of this blue area and then the other side, is where there are the most access points from private properties, and these happen to be, of course, in commercial use, so it's not just a residential in and out of the driveway a few times a day. And they're across from each other, and it's a very windy stretch of road. So it is really a challenging part of it, and they would like to have more discussions about potentially having left turn lanes or a little bit of a shoulder respite or something, because they're very worried about it. So that's why it's only that little blue chunk. The rest of the north side of 92 really doesn't have that condition.
Let me just confirm this. Okay. Those particular property owners have asked to be included?
No, okay. We're studying.
I heard they, so I was wondering what that was.
If I said they, it was probably with respect to Half Moon Bay community participants in the outreach process. Yeah.
Thanks very much.
Mm-hmm. Council members, other questions?
I have no questions because all the questions were good and I concur with them. So just adding my support for including the Moon Ridge in the plan area, because I think the people of Moon Ridge clearly identify with being part of Half Moon Bay, and that makes sense to be inclusive of that. If there's no other questions, I'm happy to make a motion. But so,
did you need some more? And you asked us about the charrette. Okay.
Your staff report includes a motion drafted for your consideration, and it relates to the three things that we've presented tonight. The charrette, which is really about that general, the sequencing, the timing, scope, process, and that we have an ad hoc committee, that you're okay with that. Two is the planning area boundary. I'm hearing a lot about Moon Ridge, but we would like to hear your action on that through this motion. And then the third one is the planning area boundary, and that would be your comfort with what we've mapped or revisions to that, and then we can finalize the map. Sorry, thank you for that one.
And I think the one outstanding thing that I've not heard discussion about and not suggested it needs to be included is Oak Park, whether or not that's intended to be included. Did I hear you mention that? It's not mapped here now, but it's very close to that pedestrian bridge. And given what Councilmember Ruddick just said, there might be some implications in terms of funding down the road and opportunities.
I'm sorry, so I misunderstood. So Oak Park, as is not included?
I didn't draw it in because
it
really didn't come up.
Great. Yep. So I think I'm definitely going to include that, especially given that neighborhood. Okay. All right. So I don't know that the recommended motion in the staff report is specific enough. Is it, if I cover the recommended motion, does that cover all the topics if I add in Oak Park?
If you have any revisions, like the Oak Park.
I want to reflect this conversation. I don't.
Okay.
So just to be clear, so it's Oak Park, it's Moon Ridge, it's the area on 92 on the north side of the highway for the boundary, correct? That's this discussion. And then there was specifically the charrette, which of course I concur with. And there was that it? Is it? Okay. So I'll follow the recommendation motion and I'll clarify with my comments. So move to confirm the project area and core area boundaries and approve the general sequence and scope of the plan Half Moon Bay work plan, including conclusion of the community workshop synthesis process before the end of 2015 and incorporation of a charrette component in early 2016, noting that the boundary areas are inclusive of Moon Ridge, the section of Highway 92, north of Highway 92 designated in the attachments, as well as Oak Park.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Abstained? Motion passes completely. Thank you. Move now to item number 9, filling a vacant general plan advisory committee seat. And we'll hear from John Dowdy this evening, our community development director.
Thank you, Mayor, Council Members. John Dowdy, Interim Community Development Director. Tonight, as you recall, last meeting, we had a lot of the conversation about the general plan update. Included in that discussion was the issue of how to fill the general plan advisory committee vacancy. On August 20th, staff received notice that one of our members, a public at-large member, Mr. Adler, was going to be stepping down from the GPAC, or the General Plan Advisory Committee. He again filled this one of the seats for the public at-large members. The General Plan Advisory Committee is comprised of 13 standing members and 5 alternates. And there's a lot of background in the staff reports. I won't go over in great detail of that. There was discussion last meeting about the issues of appointment, and we didn't have a lot of that backup and information about how the General Plan Advisory Committee was appointed the first time around. So we provided that background. In general, in 2013, the council appointed a subcommittee. That subcommittee reviewed the applications and materials and then made a recommendation of a slate of candidates filling the 18 seats, and that was elected and voted in at council meeting by majority vote. At this point, there is no set process. This is really a policy decision of the council in terms of how to appoint this. There are members still on the list from that prior recruitment. Clearly, you could suggest that we go out with another opening for interested parties. Staff has identified 2 options. One, which is to follow basically the same path that you did in 2013 as a council, appointing subcommittee and then getting a recommendation, or the second one thrown in for your consideration is just choose a member from the existing list and to fill the public at large seat. And those are really out there, but clearly this is a policy decision and up to the council to choose how you wish to proceed. Thank you.
Thank you. Vice Mayor Kowalczyk?
Quick question. Are there not alternates as part of the current GPAC?
There are. There are 3 alternates that are public members, and then there are alternate for the Parks and Recreation Committee and one from the Planning Commission. So those are 5 alternates.
So it's the full GPAC plus there's 5 alternates that are
18
that active,
members total
that actively participate. Okay. So I'd like to hear what the council says, but I think it's reasonable to consider the idea of moving one of the alternates onto the committee, but I want to hear other comments.
Do the alternates attend all the meetings? Have they been attending?
The alternates have been very participative. So that's not, I would say that's not an issue with that. I know, and that, just to come back from the last meeting, that was an initial recommendation to the council to consider bringing forward an alternate to from that point, but there was discussion about that, and that's why in this report you find 2 additional alternatives to that from that, and the public did speak to that issue as well on October 6th.
right. And what is the pleasure of the council?
Oh, I would like to suggest that Councilmember Ruddock and I form a subcommittee to pick someone, since there was the issue of our not having been involved in the initial thing. And I see no problem with picking one of the members that has already applied. I think there were originally 18 applications made to the commission, and out of that, what, 10 people chosen or 15 people chosen? I forget the numbers, but there are a bunch of people that were not picked that originally applied. And so to avoid a long, lengthy process, it might be easier for us to pick somebody from that group that had already applied.
You've got 13 regular members and 5 alternate members, which it's indicated that they have been attending. Do you want to form a subcommittee to choose from those alternates so no one has to get up to speed? You've got the 5 fully engaged alternates and choose one from them?
I would like us to be able to consider the alternates plus folks from the existing list and look at it, you know, in a detailed investigative way, you know, and bring back a recommendation to the council.
Sounds good to me.
Yeah. Motion?
Dr. Penrose? I don't think so.
No, we don't need motion. Okay, so we have a subcommittee appointed, Councilmember Penrose and Councilmember Ruddock, and they are suggesting they'll choose from the alternates who are currently on there and possibly an additional one, but it's just to replace the one position.
Mm-hmm.
Right. One spot. Okay. Sounds good.
All right. Thank you.
All right. Are we good?
I was really hoping we'd fight more over that for that. But
no, we're moving on because we don't feel well tonight. I'm sorry. Mr. Rohrbach, you are a public forum person on this.
good evening, Council. I'm in favor, Harvey Rohrbach, 464 Pine Avenue, speaking as a public-private citizen tonight. I'm in favor of this action to have the 2 new council members select a replacement for the GPAC. GPAC is very, very important, and I really think it should be done carefully. And if you look at the list of people who applied 2 years ago, there's one name that really sticks out, somebody who knows more about the environmental issues in Half Moon Bay and has worked harder and probably done more to help the city than anybody else. I'm talking about Jimmy Benjamin. Jimmy Benjamin has been demonized in the past, and it's about time that we end this divisiveness and appoint somebody who really can help the city. So I urge the council to select for the GPAC, Jimmy Benjamin. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. We'll move now to item number 10, Neighborhood and Community Outreach, Highway 1, Traffic Safety and Congestion Relief Improvements.
Thank you, Mayor, Council Members. John Dowdy again. Hopefully this is a pretty simple item. We have 2 pretty significant commitments of funding at this point from the San Mateo County Transportation Authority, roughly $7 million. In hand to do 2 pieces of Highway 1 improvements. One basically from Wave Crest just past South Main Street, and then the other from basically North Main up to roughly Kehoe or thereabouts. We came back to you in the spring to talk a little bit about these and bring really the community up to date on where we were, the new council members up to date, and current council and all people up to date on this project. And we've been working through the process of revising traffic studies and the project engineering reports that are required by Caltrans to move forward and on this deal. One of the pieces that we also asked for recommendations in the council did authorized was to proceed with a neighborhood and community outreach effort. Attached to this report is a pretty simple plan, but I think the beauty is in its simplicity, which is that really we have very defined neighborhoods, particularly in the northern area of this project. Each will have conveyed comments in the past. Each, I think, will have additional comments and valuable comments toward the end of getting to a final kind of scoped and design for the project. And then we have sort of a broader scale of community and interest from the property owners. On the 22nd, your Mobility and Transportation Subcommittee, made up of the mayor and Councilmember Penrose, met, and they did authorize us to proceed to the council with this plan. And we are asking for your support tonight to begin with our neighborhood and community outreach process for the Highway 1 projects. Thank you.
Thank you. And for several months, Councilmember Penrose and I have met with staff to go over a lot of this, and I know there's been great interest as we've worked on the west side of the highway connecting trails. This is traffic safety that can is really truly traffic safety in some areas, improving that, especially at North Main, where there'll be a light. People have asked for east-west connections and pedestrian trails on the eastbound side. So this is the start of connecting a lot of this. So council, any questions, any comments, or entertain a motion?
I'd like to move that we approve the neighborhood and community outreach plan for the safety and congestion relief improvements for Highway 1 for segments between Wavecrest Road and Kehoe Avenue.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
To oppose, abstain, hearing none, motion passes completely. Thank you, council. We'll move now to item number 11. Don't let me forget, I do have a card on that. And we'll go to Kenyatta Creek Biological Resource Evaluation, addition to routine drainage maintenance program.
I'm back. John Dowdy, Interim Community Development Director. Thank you. As you recall, we've been working, and Alex gave you a nice update on a lot of things that have been happening with the storm readiness preparations for this winter. In this process, we were approached by a number of people concerned about Kenyatta Verde, but of course, Don Fries is the unofficial mayor of the Kenyatta Verde, the mobile home park there. But he's been very engaged with this, and I think is a very strong representative for the neighbors and the community there. But anyway, we were approached by Mr. Fries and others about their concerns about Kenyatta Verde Creek and about what this might bring over the winter time. Kenyatta Verde Creek has never been on the city's list of maintained creeks or drainage ways or anything with that. So this is a bit of a new proposition for us. However, it is fully within the city, at least a piece from Highway 1 to the ocean. And based on that, went ahead and initiated the biological assessment. SWCA environmental consultants did prepare that. Interestingly, one of the biologists, her grandmother lives in the mobile home park, so she was extremely interested in this and concerned from a very personal side as well as from her professional perspective. So I thought that was interesting. In any event, the good news was that from her perspective, she said, "I feel great for my grandmother. She's at no risk this winter, nor did they think for the next several winters." There was very little down material and issues within the creek that would create problems. And so the good news is that there doesn't appear to be a significant concern and issue for the coming winter. And that also means that we hopefully won't have to be in there on an emergency basis this winter, should we have the storms and events, and we can focus on some of the other areas. That being said, this was really the first step in terms of that biological assessment toward adding this to our routine maintenance program. As indicated in the report, that creek currently does not have public easements over it. So one of the issues that we would need to do before doing anything is to have the okay of the property owners adjacent to that and ultimately have easements to be able to access and maintain it. But beyond that, this will take a environmental analysis, CEQA documentation. It'll take a coastal development permit, and ultimately an amendment to our stream bed alteration agreement with the California Department of Fish and Wildlife. So this is not an insignificant process, and so we don't take this lightly, nor do we ask you to do so, but this is where we stand, and I think our recommendation stands, which is to authorize us to initiate the process and move this forward toward putting this toward the routine maintenance program. Thank you.
Thank you. And for the public, Cañada Verde Creek is the creek that is between Cañada Cove Mobile Home Park and the Lynx course of the golf course, and the homes are along Creekside Drive. So we do have one card, and that is from James Benjamin.
Thank you, Mayor Frazier. Nice glasses. Good evening, members of the City Council and the public. I'm Jimmy Benjamin, 400 Pilarcitos Avenue. Thanks for what you said earlier, Harvey. That was nice. This is an item, you're going to hear an item in a couple of minutes where we're going to discover that flooding is not as big an issue as some people thought it was, maybe not an issue at all, and erosion is a big issue. And I'm not like the stakeholder in this Cañada Cove development. I really respect the fact that it's an important decision, and everybody has to weigh these things differently. But I included a slide in your deck tonight, and there's a picture up on the screen that shows the flood rate insurance map for Cañada Cove. It's in Zone X, so it's not in a flood zone. It's not in a 100-year flood zone. It's not in a 500-year flood zone. And the general shape of it is similar to the shape that you see in the upper map. That's a picture of Cañada Verde Creek in 1940 from the War Department. So the question I think that needs to be asked as part of the process of assessing the risk is, how has the hydrology of the drainage changed? If the drainage has gotten a lot of development and there's much flashier flows coming down, I can understand how there may be a substantial risk. If there's a history of flooding, given the patterns that are in place today, there could be a risk. If there are suddenly a lot of new trees going down, there could be risks. If none of those things aren't happening, I think it makes some sense to be cautious in how you plan to modify the drainage, because when you remove vegetation from the banks and beds, you're altering the habitat where California red-legged frogs have been found, and you're creating new sources of water to flow that can create an erosion problem that doesn't exist today. So I'm not saying that we shouldn't study it, that we shouldn't consider the plan. It is more like an A-stream in the sense that it's a natural drainage. But I think we should understand the hydrology and go in very carefully if we go in at all. Thank you.
Thank you. Bring it back to council. Any questions, comments?
Just a quick question. Can property owners deny you access legal counsel?
Private property owners certainly could take that position. Practically speaking, based on some conversations that we've had with property owners, it's unlikely that's going to be one of the problems we have. For example, if we don't get access from the mobile home parks, there's also reverse access from the golf course. The golf course has indicated an openness to having allowing the city to access that area, so I don't think that will prove a problem, but ultimately private property owners could not elect to allow the city an easement over their property, certainly.
Thank you. So I think it's a beginning, so I would move to authorize staff to initiate discussions with adjoining property owners regarding access and maintenance of Kanata Verde Creek within the city limits, and upon successful negotiation, initiate adding Kanata Verde Creek to the drainage maintenance program, including processing a coastal development permit, CDP, and amendment of the stream bed alteration agreement with the California Department of Fish and Wildlife, CDFW, for routine drainage maintenance.
I'll second.
It's been moved and seconded. All in favor, say aye.
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 Aye. Opposed? Abstained? Motion passes completely. Thank you. We move now to item number 12, our last item of the evening, report on Kehoe Conveyance Channel, hydrology and hydraulic study.
As I say, last but not least, certainly.
You saved the fun for last, yes.
Thank you, Mayor, Council Members, John Dowdy. Tonight we have several esteemed members from Schaff and Wheeler, but tonight Eliza McNulty will be making the presentation to you on the findings of their hydrologic and hydraulic analysis for Kehoe. I am going to take very little time because I think most people are quite familiar with the background and a lot of issues and a lot of discussions regarding this. The report, I think, provides some additional detail and background. What I can say is I think this is really, I think, the preferable way in some regards to begin many of the analyses and much of the work that we need to do, which is what Mr. Benjamin was saying really about a lot of things, is to do the technical analyses and then try to figure out how do you work through the challenges and issues based on actual field data and technical analyses. So this, I think, provides some important background information, some new information, new knowledge, and it's a starting point for the consultation that we're committed to doing with federal and state agencies with regard to the Kehoe and a number of other things. So we'll certainly Eliza back here take over, and then we can answer questions after that or take public comment and then answer questions. Thanks.
Thank you.
Hi. Thank you. Hi. Again, my name is Liza. I am a principal at Schaff and Wheeler and the project manager for our effort on Kehoe Ditch. Let's see. Okay. The scope and approach of our study. What we did is determine the existing hydrologic and hydraulic conditions in Kehoe Ditch. I'm going to step through that. Existing conditions. We did not look at any of the alternatives that you've heard about previously in detail. Hydrologic. Hydrology is effectively the study of how much water is produced by a given storm event. Hydraulics is the study of how that water behaves once it reaches the system that you're interested in. The reason why we want to look at the existing hydrologic and hydraulic conditions is so that we can identify the likely causes of the erosion affecting the ditch and provide design parameters for any future projects that the city undertakes. To do this, we build models. I'll get into what goes into those models through this presentation, but these are publicly available industry standard models that are developed by the Corps of Engineers. The first step of understanding how much water is produced is determining how much area drains to Kehoe watershed. I'm not sure how well you can see on this presentation, but the one in front of you perhaps. The area shown in pink hatching here is the watershed as it was defined by the 1978 Storm Drain Master Plan. That's the last time that the hydrology in this area was looked at in detail. So that was sort of our starting point. Then we met with city staff and worked with city staff to understand what the storm drain infrastructure is. And did you see that pop up right there? This entire storm drain network has been built since 1978. That storm drain network has a significant impact on the flows in Kehoe Ditch. There's a blue dotted line here. That's a 15-inch storm drain pipe. And this system up here is a 48-inch storm drain pipe.
And just the question that you, or the area you've got highlighted, that's Casa Del Mar.
I'm sorry, this is Casa Del Mar?
No.
That's not.
This is Terrace.
No. That's right. Terrace, got it, okay.
Yes. So in deciding how to include these storm drain analyses in our report, the first thing we did is went out into the field. And we were able to field verify this 48-inch pipe and confirm that it's in good condition. It's maintained well, it's open, it's placed well to intercept flows. We were not able to field verify this 15-inch because of its location on private property. In addition, 15 inches is relatively small when we're talking about things like the 100-year storm event. So in order to be conservative, our watershed delineation assumed that this 15-inch pipe was either blocked or flowing full, already full of water. Essentially, that means we assume that this 15-inch doesn't exist for the purposes of our analysis. However, we do include this 48-inch, and so this entire area, which previously flowed to Kehoe Ditch, does not. In addition, you'll see a small area here that the 1978 analysis did have flowing to Kehoe Ditch. We did field recon on this area. There have been two new inlets constructed right here on, remind me the name? Spindrift. Right where before Spindrift hits Highway 1. And so the area of this field does indeed flow in this general direction, but would be picked up by those inlets and delivered across via the storm drain system across Highway 1 directly to Pilarcitos Creek. The result is a reduction of watershed area of about 40%. This corresponds to a decrease in the 100-year flow from about 570 cubic feet per second to 240 cubic feet per second. So once we determine how much, the next question is, what does it do once it gets there? This is basically a visual interpretation of our hydraulic model. The first step to building our hydraulic model was to send a survey crew out there to gather data on the existing channel. They took points at cross sections up and down the channel, and then we put those cross sections into our hydraulic model. What they found is at near the downstream end of the channel itself sort of disappears. It widens, it becomes very standing water with undefined banks. The reason for that they found and confirmed in the field, is a berm across the horse trail. The horse trail exists in this area. We'll take a closer look at this where you can see it better. And there's a berm there. It's effectively a dam in the channel. And so that causes a bathtub effect. The water backs up behind that. Another important parameter that goes into a hydraulic analysis is something called the Manning's coefficient. A Manning's coefficient is a parameter that captures the condition of the channel. With a very clean, well-maintained channel, you have a low Manning's value. That results in a lower water surface elevation, but higher velocities. For a very densely vegetated channel, you end up with a high Manning's N value. That gives you high water surface elevations, but lower velocities. The water slows down. We looked at a range of Manning's N values so that we were sure we were capturing for future design the worst case scenario in case, you know, for a new channel if it was maintained differently. This is the existing conditions, that higher N value, more densely vegetated. This is based on assuming, you know, on brush and weeds actually in the channel, having a lot of ineffective areas. So looking a little closer in that downstream area, in blue here, you see the berm. This is the horse trail coming in, and they've bermed up over time. It has been bermed up to allow the trail to cross without having to cross the creek. The area in red is the maximum ponding that occurs before the berm is overtopped. Water is in this area, in this downstream reach, and all the way up here. all the time. In August of this year, the end of a dry season, 4 years into a drought, there was standing water in that area. Standing water leads to saturated soils. Saturated soils have very low strength. They fail. It also leads to impacts to the vegetation. If the vegetation is not used to saturated soils, it too will fail. When the berm is overtopped, water flows along the horse trail until it reaches Pilarcitos Creek. That's very different from the historic alignment where the water would flow generally northerly to its confluence with Pilarcitos Creek. Another outcome, this is one more photo showing the same from the ocean looking back. So this is Kehoe Ditch coming here, and it's again difficult to tell on the scale, but that berm is right about here. And so you get this backwater condition in this whole area.
And that's where the horses cross.
Yes.
And that's where this berm is.
Exactly. Another outcome of our study was to establish water velocities. I know there's a lot of numbers on this slide. The takeaway is that for effectively all scenarios, velocities are high enough to have erosive potential. That's not a surprise. That's probably true of 90% of all natural channels in the state of California. It's worth noting that the highest velocities are up here at the upstream reach. And that's because the channel is smaller there. The channel cross section is a bit smaller. It's a pinch point, so water speeds up to get through it. Because of these high velocities and the resulting design criteria that comes from that, any future project will require some engineered or bioengineered tow and bank protection. Oops, wrong button. Another goal of our study was to look at the water surface elevations throughout the creek. Again, a lot of information on this slide. What's important is this dotted line on the top. This is the north bank of the creek. So here we're at the upstream end of the creek. We're at Highway 1. We're traveling down the creek until we get to that ponded area, to that bathtub. And so this is the profile of the channel bank along that area. And the line directly under it is our 100-year water surface elevation. It's the level of water given the current conditions, the higher N value through the channel. And what you'll see is although the water reaches the bank, the top of the bank, in a few locations, it does not exceed it. So the 100-year flow under existing conditions is contained in the channel. So to summarize those results, which I just went through, the storm drain infrastructure over the last 35 years, those improvements, have decreased the flows to Kehoe Ditch by some 40% for the watershed area. At the downstream end, we have a backwater condition that creates saturated soils. Those saturated soils have lower strength and are therefore susceptible to failure. At the upstream end, the causes of erosion are really localized. We have that pinch point in the channel and in areas where we have higher velocities. We also have a number of failed countermeasures. Over the years, folks have tried to fix specific locations of the creek by putting in rock riprap or concrete. Unfortunately, piecemeal efforts to stabilize a channel are just as likely to cause more harm than good, and that is what has occurred. Additional scour happens around that improvement until eventually the improvement itself fails and there's scour left behind when it does. We also saw downspouts all along the creek and witnessed some localized scour at those downspout locations. So the conclusions we can draw from these results, as I said earlier, the 100-year flooding is not anticipated to occur under the existing channel conditions. The causes of the current bank failure and erosion are different between the upstream and the downstream reaches. That means that we're looking at really dramatically different projects or alternatives to fix the specific issues facing those or driving that erosion. It's really important to note that horse path, remediation of that horse path, removing that blockage in the channel, It's going to involve a lot of stakeholders, both private and public. In addition to private residents or horse riders who use it, there's going to be a lot of environmental regulators who have jurisdiction and interest in that area. And lastly, any project alternative requires engineering or bioengineering solution at the toe and the bank in order to protect it from the velocities that we found. And with that, I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you. This is fascinating to learn. I mean, we can blame it all on the horses, right? We do have a card on this, and then we'll bring it back to council. Jimmy Benjamin?
I love this report. Let's see. I did something wrong. Help me. It's just going randomly now. Thank you very much. So this presentation was about existing conditions. We heard a lot about storm drainage. Erosion was not as deeply considered in this report, but I would like to acknowledge that there were some improvements in the project that came up today. I spoke with John Dowdy on Monday, right after I read through the report, and I appreciate the fact that the consultants took the time to address some of the concerns. There are a couple of concerns that I just want to be sure that we are aware of, but I want to go in with the understanding that I want to believe this result about the 100-year flood. The fact that there were a couple of points on that graph where it came right up to the bank, that demonstrates the sensitivity of the model at certain places to the parameters that were used. So one of the questions that I asked in my note was about that coefficient that she referred to as Manning's in, that characterizes the roughness of the component. So I noticed that in the staff report that CSG put together back in 2008, prior to the Kehoe Quinning project that became the source of so much unfortunate acrimony for all of us, the analysis that you see on the slide there in the red square shows the Manning number of 8. 0.08. 8 would be pretty scary. Now, I am not this kind of engineer, so I'm not here to tell you what the right number is. I just see two different knowledgeable people with different numbers, and I understand that this thing is really basically trying to take a complex stream with varying depths that has pools, that has vegetation growing in the bottom, that has sinuous curves in some areas, and approximating it by a behavior that's consistent across the channel. That's risky, and that means that it's important for us to understand that a lot more carefully. But rather than arguing about what the number should be, I think the right answer is to take advantage of the weather we're having this year to measure it and actually see what the flows are. So I think we could back solve for the right numbers for N, and not just for this stream, but maybe for some of the other streams as well. I also want to point out that that 15-inch stream, 15-inch pipe that was spoken to earlier, actually, this is a map I got from the city back in 2011. And in addition to the 15-inch pipe, if you look very closely at this copy, you'll see close to the bottom, there's a little pipe that juts out and then parallels the main 15-inch pipe down to Highway 1 and then moves around north. My suspicion, and it's only a suspicion, is that that is an outflow pipe, so that when the stream cannot, when the pipes cannot handle the amount of water that's being run through them, it pushes the water over into the Kehoe watercourse. Now, maybe I'm wrong, maybe I'm right, I don't know. But if you'll bear with me, since this is such an important topic, Your Honor. The implications of this drainage is, since we haven't verified it, a really conservative assumption would be to assume that it's moving water down into this area, and during high peak flows, it may be dumping water into the Kehoe watercourse through this channel. Even if it's not dumping the water at that through that because of that watercourse, it's possible that high flows in the Chesterfield pipe could saturate, especially with this new development going on at Terrace and Highland and above it in the Pacific Ridge area, could create so much demand that it could conceivably have backflow, absent a very expensive check valve that I doubt exists there. And this may be very unrealistic, but I think since the stakes are so high, it's worth talking about it long enough to exclude it. So I think that the sedimentation and erosion issues in this area, combined with the assessment of these flows that we've been discussing, warrant additional conversations. I don't think we're done with this. We certainly have to address the erosion. For whatever reason, it's there, it's a fact, it is damaging, it needs to be repaired. So I'm looking forward to continuing the conversation with you, with Jack, with John, and with our consultants. Thank you very much.
Thank you. That's all the cards we have on this. Council, any questions or discussion?
Just a comment. First of all, I very much appreciate the analysis in this report and the data behind it. It's been a long time since I've done engineering, but I just like looking at it, so thank you for that. And in terms of the private property you didn't have access to, we can arrange access to it because we own it. So that's our property. But the fact that you took a conservative assumption and just assumed what was there, I think is the right approach. So I don't think that would change, even if you did have access. So a conservative approach makes sense. So I just thank you for the report. I don't have any other questions on it.
Council members, any comments?
Yeah, just again, excuse me, like to thank the professionals that have looked at this, because everyone thinks they're professionals in, when it comes to moving water, but you guys did, a very fine job with this, number one. Number two, when you don't have an outlet at the bottom of a ditch or a creek or whatever, it does cause an issue, as you've explained, and I think that's probably a very important area that we have to look at in the future here. And I mentioned to my fellow council member here that I don't know if Sam owns that property or who would own it, but I think that's something we're going to have to investigate to see who the real property owner is. And, you know, in history, they would just go ahead and Tony Cardoza would get the TD9 and bulldoze a ditch out to the ocean. And Pescador Creek is facing that with serious flooding every year also because of our regulatory agencies that are managing our coastlines properly. And so I think that's a real beginning to see where that flow is. And then I think we have to be concerned about property owners diverting water to the back ditch there instead of possibly putting it into the streets for storm drain control. But I think it's a beginning. Again, we've gone through a lot of agony with this area for a few homeowners there that need to be addressed. And so I'm comfortable with the recommendation at this time.
Any other comments, council members? Councilmember Reddick.
I kind of like the idea of taking a snapshot of conditions during the rainy season, photo or otherwise. I think it would be good to understand how it actually functions in real time under real, you know, weather conditions. I don't have a clue as to what the winter is going to hold in terms of overall precipitation, but I think it's worth gathering the data and, you know, perhaps in other drainages as well, like Seymour, although I noticed that we've lost a lot of land along the Seymour Channel, even during the dry weather. We've lost something like several feet, I think, on either side of the bank without without water. So I'd rather not go a full 90 days and not do anything. I'd like us to collect some more data if we can. And certainly I think it's worth looking at the pinch points at the far eastern edge of the drainage. Seems to make sense to me. I think it's a very thorough study. I don't have any issues at all with the approach or the data that's been collected. I think we just need to translate this into some sort of recommendation for, you know, for action sooner rather than later. But if we want to bring it back in 90 days, I think we should bring it back with some additional data collection and more refined recommendations for an approach, perhaps cost estimates for taking care of those, you know, pinch points. I do agree that piecemeal approach is not good. We see that with seawalls. We know in California where there's a seawall down coast, there's always a problem with serious erosion. So I think we need a uniform approach to the banks, and you know, one that meets and respects the environmentally sensitive habitats of the area. But we need a uniform approach, and certainly get the downspouts out of the drainage. I think that should be a fix that we look at in pretty short order. We know from the county's dump downspout at the Seymour Channel that that's really been adding to the head cutting for years and still can be a problem as well. So we can get the downspouts out, take a uniform approach to the bank stabilization. I think we're moving toward a solution. I feel a lot better about things now that we have this report. And Jimmy, of course, has provided some great additional information for consideration as we move forward. So that's kind of where I'm going with this, is a little more data collection on observable water flow, and then coming back with refined, more detailed recommendations.
I agree. I think this is a fine report, and it really sheds some new light on where some of the problems are. So I think you've done a really good job. Where are you? Oh, you're right there. Thank you.
So, yeah, the report just seems to take a lot of the speculation out of the things we've been discussing for over the years. And to Councilmember Ruddick, in terms of what you are interested in seeing, is it anecdotal? Here are photos of flow during the during a rain, or are you asking that we have a plan and take measurements of flows during a rain or periodically? Or could you be more specific?
Well, I'm going to leave that up to city staff, the engineer, and the consultants to figure out. What we want is information, usable information that will inform, you know, the solutions that we take forward. In other words, you know, maybe there's a flow meter that lies in the bottom of the channel, or a couple of them at different points in the channel. We want to be able to measure and observe the flow. So whatever data collection method they think would be useful to inform the hard solutions.
Yeah, I would agree with that. I would welcome a recommendation from the consultant to us. That'd be great. Thank you.
Staff, do you have enough information?
Yes, I think we do. Thank you very much.
I would move to receive the report from Jeff Wheeler, Consulting Civil Engineers on the Kehoe Hydrology and Hydraulics Study, and direct staff to return within, as soon as possible, 90 days. I added that to the motion, I'm sorry. For the discussion and direction based upon the findings and the results of the study. But I think you understood what we were looking for there.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. All in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? Abstentions? Motion passes completely. Thank you. Good meeting tonight, Council. And remember, Sunday afternoon, concerts in the park. Let's dance to Beatles music, 1 to 3. Don't forget the 8 o'clock.